warm welcome that I received. Unfortunately, I cannot hold this presentation in Portuguese. So I'll try hard, and next time maybe I can do a little bit better. Before I come to the topic, I think it's very important for you to understand what is this company that I'm talking about, that I'm representing here tonight, what is this company all about? And it needs some explanation. It's always good to show a little bit or to go a little bit into the history, because the first, let's say, idea of this company actually came up by chance, and not by a very positive event, but by a hijacked plane. A hijacked Lufthansa plane that was hijacked in the late 70s and that ended up in Mogadishu in Somalia. Some of you might remember. German terrorist time, so not a very nice event. And the German government was actually allowed to bring their special forces to Somalia, which was a big move by the local government, which nobody really expected. And they were able to save all the hostages and free everybody, and nobody of the hostages was actually killed. When this was a Lufthansa 737 plane, when everybody came back safely, the German government sat together and thought about what can we actually give as a favor to the Somali government. And they asked the Somali government, and the president at that time asked the German government whether they would be able to support Somalia in setting up its own airline, in setting up a civil aviation entity, a civil aviation authority, and helping the country to, let's say, kick off its aviation business. And of course, at that time, Lufthansa as a group was one company, 100% state-owned. So the Minister of Transportation went to the CEO of Lufthansa and asked him to put together a team of experts. And that was actually the very start of the idea of founding a consultancy company within the Lufthansa Group. So after 2 years, they've settled everything. A civil aviation authority was in place. Somali Airlines was in the air. And they were thinking about why not pursuing this idea in other countries as well. So it became part of a Lufthansa strategy department, and actually 25 years ago it was spinned off as a separate company, as a separate limited company, and it's active worldwide. It's actually selling aviation know-how to the aviation world. So we do work within the Lufthansa Group, but we also do work for other airlines and for other airports. Just to give you an idea, the external share of our turnover is roughly 80%, and 20% is the internal Lufthansa business. And out of this external part, I would guess roughly a quarter is dedicated to airport clients, and three quarters are still focused on the airline business and on civil aviation authorities. So that is the overall idea. It has developed in the meantime, so it's a team of 100 people, roughly 80 consultants traveling the world all the time, doing projects in the aviation industry for airports, airlines and governments globally, and 20 support staff being located in Cologne, in Frankfurt and in Moscow. And we are about to open another office in Brazil soon. So far to the background of the company. Let us talk about European airport systems. So we heard an introduction to the topic already. One could talk hours and write books about European airport systems. So we needed to concentrate the topic a little. And when looking at, let's say, the last 20 years, there has been a dramatic change in airports. And this change was partly in ownership structures. It was, of course, driven by increased demand. And you're in a very interesting situation here in Portugal with let's say privatization just ongoing. That was the thought why I think it is very interesting also to have a look ahead what comes next and how the structure will change within the future, not only for Portugal but also for other European countries. So I will be spending a little focus on how privatized airports will change and what that means to a company which is state-owned today and will be part of a private group tomorrow. What is the structure that I'm thinking about? I, of course, have to go into the privatization topic a little. Some theory, I hope not too much, about public-private partnerships. There are different types. I'll talk about that later on. I give you a status quo of Europe today, which is not easy because it's so fragmented. And we'll be talking about what does it mean to a company running an airport within a state-owned ownership, and what will it change, or what are the changes that can be expected on a general basis? I will have some examples. And maybe also for ANA. And last not least, of course, what is the management, let's say, challenge around it? Is it still a system? Because the European airport systems already brings along that it is a system and it will be a system, but how does this international system look like? So one would also already be on the way to write European airport network, which implies that there's some airlines in place as well, and they do of course have a very significant say in here. I do have some references from projects that we have been conducting in the past, which fit very well to this topic. If we come so far, then we can talk about that. Otherwise, I will open the discussion if it becomes too late. Okay, so let's talk about those kinds of infrastructure. This is Munich Airport, Munich in Germany. I think well known, it's Lufthansa's second most important location, has a hub function, and just taking this picture and comparing that to an airport, let's say 20, 30 years ago, will give tremendous, or will indicate tremendous differences. So in earlier times, you had an airport being a pure infrastructure provider. And not so much focused on different businesses, not so much focused on the generation of non-aeronautical revenues that we learned, and not so much focused on the different function that an airline has. And this airport was dedicated and was built to facilitate a hub function. So, and from every single design aspect, from the terminal to the runways, from the apron, you see that right away this airport was constructed as a hub airport. And it facilitates the needs of Lufthansa. So you see right away that this airline obviously had a very big impact and a very big influence into how this airport was built. And actually, Lufthansa is even in a joint venture running the operation of its hub terminal together with the airport. So they came in, they even invested money, they invested a lot of planning power, they have a joint team running this facility. So a very interesting concept which was known to the not known to the aviation business before. So that just gives an indication. It looks very American, I would say. All those linear concepts where you can have the lineup of many gates, where you have the opportunity of fast interchanges between the different aircraft, and where you could facilitate strong and short minimum connecting times between the different arrivals and departures. And that's its main purpose. And today, this, if you look at the passenger numbers, There is more transfer passengers, more passengers connecting from one plane to the other, than you have people that actually want to go to Munich or that come from there. And that's a huge shift, which was actually pushed by different airline business models, but which has a dramatic impact of how an airport is run and how an airport is built and how the money is spent in airport infrastructure. Simple question, but important ones. This European airport system, if I call it so, has, for me, it's still unbelievable, an unbelievable number of 402 scheduled served airports in Europe. And Europe is a relatively small continent if you compare it to other ones. And you have more than 250 commercial airlines serving those airports. And of course you have a top class, the bigger ones, serving the lion's share of the traffic. And there are the ones like London, Heathrow, Frankfurt, Paris, which facilitate more than 50 million passengers a year. So the traffic growth that we have seen, and the traffic growth which is still behind each and every expansion plan, is huge. So from a logical point of view, facilitating this growth is a very capital intense business. And especially if you compare that to our European standard regulatory scheme, which always brings along long planning times. So from the very first moment you start thinking about airport capacity until the moment you have that capacity in place, it normally takes centuries. So we are not in China, where people are obviously able to build such an infrastructure within some years, sometimes within 2 years. It normally takes centuries. So this is another challenge we have to bear in mind. Forget about the details here, but what I wanted to show you, if you think along that financing line, and if you would be somebody who has some spare money and you would put that into a business, you would normally tend to avoid aviation. Aviation, unfortunately, is one of the least profitable industries we have. And even worse, what you would definitely want to avoid is airlines. Because airlines actually have a very low profit margin, globally. And that's the reason why, if there comes the slightest crisis, not in the slight crisis we are having in Europe today, but you see that so many of the airlines are already dropping out of the market right away because they actually have no buffer. All those business models that we see in the airline business are very, very tight calculated. And if there's a strong decrease in fuel prices, if there is a strong, let's say, push on the demand side, then they start getting critical. And this, of course, has a direct impact on the airports. So if you lose one of your clients, it can be quite dramatic. Later on, I will have the Budapest example. Budapest actually lost its most important client, Malév. So 1.5 years ago, this Malév, the Hungarian national carrier, very long history, very well known in the industry, they left the market from one day to the other. And they, I think they facilitated, or they catered for roughly 30% to 40% at this airport. What you see, as this market has so many overcapacities, is that many, many airlines came in right away and tried to fill the one or the other gap. But they couldn't do so on a 100% basis. So this airport is now being less served than it was before. If you just compare the numbers here, then the airport side looks better. Airport business obviously is one of the most profitable ones that we have in this relatively, let's say, financially uninteresting industry. And of course, this is this arises some attention from investors, and that was of course kind of a starting point to think about bringing in private money, and that is what I would like to discuss within the next chapter with you. Because actually it's not black or white. So if somebody is talking about privatization, it's always a little simplistic. Because there are so many different ways and means of privatizing an airport. And I'm not even talking about privatization anymore. I try to think about of making use of private money. Because many of the states, that's a fact, they are urgently looking to get to sell their assets in order to fill or to have some positive effects on their budgetary restraints. We've seen it here in Portugal. We are at Lufthansa Consulting running a big project for the Greek government and privatizing 37 of their regional airports. And the whole project is not being run by the government itself, but also by the Troika, who's actually taking care that the money which should pour in the future is directly transferred to them. So again, let's say rationales on both sides, on the public sector side, but also on the private side, to actually invest in airports. What is most important here on the public side is, of course, let's say, seeing a need in financing. Seeing obviously the need when you have to extend and even retain an infrastructure, that's a very costly issue. And the states are mostly not ready and not willing to finance that anymore. And if you look at the infrastructure, like I've showed you the one from Munich, it gets more and more costly to establish an airport, to run an airport, to establish the infrastructure, and to establish, let's say, all the other costs which are around the airport when it comes to noise reduction whatsoever. So that's a very costly adventure, which doesn't necessarily has to be done by a state-owned entity. For the private sector, let's say those bankers, those investment bankers, are very much focused on potential. And if you have a state-owned industry, their perception is always, we can do it more efficient on the private side, we can do it better. Yeah? If that's always the case, that's the question mark. But there's also potential to increase the revenues, and especially on the side that we've learned on the non-aeronautical side. So that's an issue here as well. So let's say, what are the different, this is not black and white but gray, what are the different options that you have? Let's say the most severe one would be a complete privatization, which by the way rarely takes place, where you sell each and everything, even the land. And then you have different, let's say, different sizes. The good size for the state is, of course, you can sell more, so your income will increase, of course. But on the other side, you have to control more, because you want that infrastructure to be operational and to serve the demand of the future. And every airport has a very important task to do for the national economy. So there's a kind of a trade-off between pulling money in but controlling in the future on the other side. But there are also companies which are not even interested in actually buying the assets, but which are more interested in having a concession for some times, or even only running the airport, managing the airport for some time, with, of course, then a lower amount of money which is handed over to the government. So those are, let's say, those is the spectrum where you can play in. Yeah. And if you look at the different airport transfers that have taken place on the capital market, it's a very different picture. What I wanted to say also, I just have this risk here. Privatization has some risks. Once you sell an airport, it's actually getting a little bit out of your control. And at many airports, we are now in kind of a second phase. So they have changed ownership to a private company, but then this private company can actually change their business strategy, like in any other industry. And as a state, then you are, let's say, a little bit bound to their strategy. So this is just taken from the news today. So there's Abertis, very important airport operator. It's getting dangerous here for me. if I get hurt. So they are obviously thinking about selling their airport activities. And they were looking out. They were one player on the market looking out for private airport investments. So that can happen each and every time. So you, as a state who is selling your airport stakes, who's selling your airport activities, you need to be aware that this can happen. And there are many companies in that way, and especially in the airport, in the private airport business, Hochtief, a German company, is trying to sell its airport activities now for 1.5 years, but they don't find somebody. But it's on the market, and everybody thinking about it. So those are the one, let's say, the key transactions that we have seen in the airport business, just by, let's say, the numbers of them. And you see that it started in the 90s, it grew dramatically in the early 2000 years, and it has kind of stabilized on a high level. And many of those are now trade sales, so meaning that one airport changes from the one company to the other. So this is effect in today's private airport management business. So let's have a look at the European situation. What I would have expected always is a European map, and then you have a lot of border lines, and everything is according to national border lines. This is not so much the case in the airport business, in the airport privatization business. So we do have a lot of international companies being active in that field, and I selected some of them in order to better understand the structure. Because what we actually see is that it differs from airport to airport. We have kind of a starting structure, which was the one that we have compared to, let's say, depended on the country in the 90s or in the early 2000 years. But since then, it's becoming more and more fragmented. Take BAA. BAA used to be the abbreviation for British Airports Authorities. So they were running all the major Great Britain airports. And then they were actually bought by Ferrovial, so by a Spanish company. And now you see that we are in the second step already, because they are in the process of reorganizing that, and they actually took over a major share of BAA, but now Ferrovial is only remaining London and Heathrow, the key airport of the country. And you see the numbers we are talking about, £10 billion for that deal at that time. Unbelievable number. Bucharest was one that was actually owned in the first activity that was taken over by BAA. Strange enough, a state-owned company buying as a privatized investor an airport. But that was already in the second circle, taken over by Hochtief Airport, so a German company, German construction company, construction and facility management company, for €1.9 billion. TPI, more looking at the medium and smaller sized airports, starting in the 1990s, Belfast, Cardiff, Luton, Stockholm, Skavsta, and this was taken over by Albertis. We just saw the news. So in 2005, and in 2012, 2013, they're already thinking about, after 8 years, to getting rid of the airport business. So you see how much activities we are seeing. Copenhagen used to be very strong before the privatization as an international, let's say, consultant. They consulted a lot of the other airports, and then they were bought by a Macquarie, Australian company. And again, now it's majority shareholder Ontario Teachers Fund. So you see that the first time that financial investors come. So running an airport seems step by step to become a commodity. Strange enough. So those private equity funds, they are of course not interested in running the airport, managing the airport. It's just a finance investment. They trust the local managers, and they, let's say, keep their fingers crossed that they are on a good track. And they just collect the money at the end of the year if there's a profit margin. Yeah, so far we've come in the airport business. It's becoming an investment target, like factories for automobile companies, where you have those finance investors, like factories for other businesses. So it's becoming a standard industry. Essence, 45% private shareholding, also by Hochtief, in operation since 2001. This was really one of the first ones. Very interesting, because that was a new airport which had to be built, and it was built directly with the private capital, because even at that time, funds didn't really look so promising in Greece. Yeah, and some other ones. Let us look a little bit into the system idea. So we had national systems. Sometimes even, let's say, a system, for a system, I kind of expect that there's something that kind of a bracket that keeps them together. So it cannot be the traffic normally, because let's say if I just take the ANA example, the traffic between the ANA airport is not what really holds them together. It's the centralized structure and the centralized management. It's not the traffic flow, and it's not the demand, it's probably not the airlines. It is ownership. But the question remains, what if I am a private investor, will I really, or am I looking to construct a new network, a new system of airports? If I go through the different examples here, I wouldn't say so. Those are not airport systems. They, by chance, seem to have the same owners. And if you look at how those companies are run, there is not so much, let's say, cooperation between the different airport locations. Let's say if you join an airport group, there is very few coordination. I will come back to that issue and tell you some of the practical examples we have discovered at Lufthansa Consulting. So let's continue. What are the big players that we have in the European market? And I try to make the dots in the color of the investor, so that we have an idea. Albertis, we heard about that company. Yeah, quite active, smaller sized airports, and some investments outside Europe. Aéroports de Paris, this is an interesting one, because they started as a national, as a state-owned company, running the Paris airports. And then they step by step moved into other locations as well, with shares. So none of them is actually 100% owned. But what they also do is what I had in the beginning. They do run some airports. Zagreb, for example, in Croatia. They manage those. but they don't come in with major investment at those locations. And what we see